going to take you through it, and you'll probably recognize where you are at. And when you join PIMBL, you go into Vault, and we've got like, what, 10 questions?
Yeah, seven.
7 questions. And we can pretty much tell you where you are just with those 7 questions, probably 98% of the time. And then we'll also tell you this is what you need to be working on, and these are the things we have that can help you. So it's been a labor of love, I guess, but it was very hard to do because we had to take everything, 7 years worth of masterminds, 32 years of practicing law.
Planned, not my intention. I got so brave.
When I first met him, we actually, I have this spreadsheet that's designed to go through 60 questions, and basically, to be quite honest, it's designed to show the lawyer that they're not doing half as much stuff as they think they could be doing, and by the end they realize, you know, they need my kind of consulting services. And Ken's the only one who stood there for an hour and said yes. Oh yeah, I'm doing that. Yeah, we're doing direct mail. Oh yeah, we got TV cards. And I remember just like at the end just stopping and say, all right, you don't need me. And we just ended up having this, you know, long-winded conversation about the stuff that he was already doing. So really, really interesting. One of the things about Ken is that the man is a genius, honestly. I know he kind of plays himself as like the NASCAR kind of Southern draw, but he actually twice built and sold a 7-figure practice, first time in Raleigh, North Carolina, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it took you about 20 years to go from solo to, yeah, is that about right?
Yeah.
And the second one he built in Myrtle Beach, it took him a year and a half to get it there, and he spent most of his time going golfing and fishing and not really doing anything that I would call real work, by the way. And so what I want to show you guys today is how to do the second one. How to do it, not in 20 years, but how to go from zero to hero in a lot less time. We actually had one of our members who just did this, was the last guy getting paid out of his law practice in 4 years. Went from nobody to, he's now taking over neighboring states, he's taking over other practice areas. 4 years ago, was not even getting a paycheck in his law firm because the cash flow situation was so bad. And so one of the really fortunate things that we get to see is what's working for everybody. You know, like part of the advantage of PILMA is we get to see really all the successful law practices around the country and what really makes it tick. So, I mean, we've both got to learn from John Morgan. I've been told Morgan & Morgan, if you're not familiar with them, they're the, if you're in the southeastern United States, you pretty much can't go 5 minutes without seeing a billboard. If you're from somewhere else, you won't recognize them. But I'm told they do $500 million with a B annually, and I'm pretty sure they're the largest firm in the country. I could be wrong on that. Some of our guys are in the top 5 TV spenders, spending $12 million a year, $1 million a month if you want to do the math. We got guys who sign up 1,500 cases. We get a pretty good vantage point of like what's working now. So that's what I want to show you guys first. So quick show of hands just to see where you guys are at. Who right now, solo practice attorney? You by yourself, I love you guys, you know why? Because you guys are like Rambo. Just do everything yourself, like cases, marketing, the whole shebang. How many of you guys right now, small team, you, couple associates, paralegal, raise your hand if that's true. You know what I love about you guys is when we get you guys in, you always tell us things like, I give my paralegal 5 problems to go solve, and she comes back with 10. So I imagine this is what you're faced before and after you delegate. So you guys are in stage 2 if you're at that level. Now, how many of you guys right now function as a manager, meaning you do not manage cases, but you manage associates, and you're very active in every single little decision that happens? Raise your hand if that's you guys. So you guys are the stage 3. And you know, you guys have so much employee drama at your stage that I always figure you're one shenanigan away from doing this. Is that not true, by the way? Anybody here working completely as a partner, meaning you don't have anything to do with the day-to-day management, you're just focused exclusively? Awesome. So this is what it looks like when you're in stage 4, by the way, and this is what it looks like. It's the corporate structure. I'll read that because you can't read it. But it says, when the top-level guys look down, they only see shit. When the bottom-level guys look up, they only see assholes. So that's your official corporate structure. And do we have anybody here who's the 800-pound gorilla in your market where you could walk away from your practice, sell it for a whole lot of money? No, okay. Well, When you get into that stage, a lot of our guys who are in that stage, it's all about culture. You know, when people say, oh, there's so much politics at my office, this is what they mean. It says, please do not waste toner. And as you can see, it's printed in full page ink. That's the office politics. So, first stage. To all you solos who answered yes, you want to pay extra attention to this. What we found is usually when you're in the solo stage, you're doing everything yourself. You're kind of in the 0 to 250 case range. And this is what a day in stage one feels like, by the way. Well, crap, now what do we do? Because you guys are fighting fires all day long and trying to use a fire extinguisher that's on fire to put it out. You know, constant interruptions, all day, things like that. So what we find is, when you're in stage one, cash flow sucks. And what I usually hear from our members in stage one is, I'm constantly worried about where the next case is from. I'm stressed out. I have really good months, roller coaster income, up and down. And it just feels like there's not enough hours in a day, right? Like when you go home, it doesn't feel like a relaxed 10-hour day. It feels like, whew, just need to decompress from that one. So what we find, obviously, you know, your big overwhelming challenge in stage one is you need more cases. But part of that challenge is you don't necessarily even realize how to go about doing it correctly. So there's a right way and a wrong way to do this. And what I've seen some of our successful members do that are in the solo stage who have grown beyond it and been able to kind of transcend that level. Matt Dubin comes to mind in Seattle, who got really good at the internet, got really good at bringing in people through SEO, through pay-per-click, and he's been able to triple his practice, I think, or something like that, and take a whole bunch of time off. He's now gets to actually spend time with his family, which if you're a solo, you know, if you take a week off from your practice, you don't have a practice. Justin Lovely in Myrtle Beach got really good at getting reviews on Google, found that, hey, people call him and say, hey, you got great reviews. John Zade told me, he's a PI lawyer in Houston, and very, very smart guy, because one of the things I hear a lot from solos is, I got no money. So, I mean, how am I supposed to compete with the 800-pound gorilla and get cases? And what John did is he just went to all the other lawyers that did PI in town and said, give me all your shit. Give me all your worst cases. I'll take them all. But it was part of a grander strategic plan, because in 2 years, he had strategies to turn those all into referrals. So he's now doing something like 100 cases a month, zero advertising budget to do it. Jerry Ojinski is a medical malpractice in New York. Many of you may know him. He's the video guy. Also love Jerry because, again, $0 advertising budget. All he does is just make friendly, helpful, let me answer your legal questions kind of videos on YouTube, and people call him from that. And what we see wrong is kind of most lawyers who are in stage one kind of represent Eric. Eric's a, I won't use his last name to keep, but he's a PI lawyer in California, and he told me, been practicing 25 years, great lawyer, gets great settlements, a month away from going out of business because never really got good at the marketing part of it. Never really good at, and unfortunately, we all know it's not a meritocracy. You know, because you're a good lawyer doesn't bring you good cases. Andrew, another one, we call these guys the recovering lawyers, where he said, if I can't make this work in another 3 months, I'm gonna go quit and work in corporate America. So what I wanna show you, obviously, is the solutions, is how to create winning marketing, vision, mission, and values to know where you're actually going. And what I want to show you is that when you're stuck in stage one, your biggest problem, even though you don't necessarily know it, is your message and how you communicate what you do to the world. So I'm going to show you something that's very political, but I don't want you to look at it through a political lens. This isn't one of those deals. I just want to show you how much a message changes perception. These are a couple days ago, Wall Street Journal, and they send different copies depending on where you are in the country and what that local area's political affiliation. And if you can read the one on the left, it says, Trump softens his tone. And the one on the right says, Trump talks tough on wall. Same picture, same everything. Drastically different perception of what you think you're reading, though, right? Just from that one sentence. And so when we see people in stage one, we always ask them, why are they stuck? And usually what we find is they're focused on being a better lawyer, and they don't realize that how they're communicating their legal skills sounds exactly like everybody else. So here's a search I did, my local area in Detroit. This is everybody telling me, injured, no fee unless you win. That's just like a montage of, you know, all the people doing it. So here's another one I did, same search. This is everybody who's experienced and gonna get me results. Good news, if you guys are ever looking for an injury lawyer, everybody's experienced and everybody's gonna get you results. So you don't have anything to worry about in choosing one. And so a lot of what we see is kind of copycat marketing and not realizing how important it is to be different. And I want to show you how important your message is or how much it can make or break a business, because, like, come on.
Oh.
So, you know, I think this is going to be awesome, because you guys are going to go home and you're going to say, oh, what was the conference like? What did you learn? Oh, there was some guy, he said, basically, don't name your law firm Anal. So the beauty is when you create a winning message, it suddenly becomes scalable, because it just becomes a matter of getting your message out there, and you'll find that it works. So this is a John Morgan commercial, one of my favorite ones. And even though I'm showing you commercials, I don't want you to get caught up on the idea that TV has anything to do with it. What I want you to pay attention to is the message, because you can do this kind of thing. The same principle applies whether you're doing Facebook or your own website or whether you're on YouTube or whether you're face-to-face with somebody in a referral meeting. Let's try that. Oh, apparently I just broke the internet. In there, Billy? In marketing terms, this is called a dramatic demonstration. What I want to show you, you know, when Ken and I kind of pick John's brain, it's all just like, it's all about marketing and the message. We good?
It's so important that you hire your lawyer sooner rather than later. Things change. Witnesses' memories fade. Evidence disappears or is repaired. Time past is your enemy. For example, what color is my suit and tie? Am I wearing cufflinks and a handkerchief? Is Emma with me? Don't wait. Call today. Things change. Morgan & Morgan, for the people.
So he kind of, you know, what's interesting is you notice he doesn't say experience and I'll get you results. He just pays attention to or points out the fact dramatically that witnesses have their memories fade. Here's another one. Awesome Pilma member, also a client of mine that I get to be fortunate enough to work with. This is Eddie Farah. If you don't know him, he's the 800-pound gorilla in Jacksonville. And what's beautiful about this message is he just uses his client testimonials to weave together a story about how he can help you without him ever saying a word, rather than the opening message.
There are lots of reasons to choose Farah and Farah.
The bills were overwhelming. They became a great burden.
You see them piling up, you know, they go from a few hundred to thousands and thousands and thousands. It was like a bad dream. It was just unbelievable.
Eddie's like, don't worry about your bills. We'll take care of the medical bills and everything. And he did.
Saved me and my son financially. He really did.
To have that weight taken off of your shoulders is just a blessing.
Farah and Farah, protecting you and your family.
So, powerful stuff. Anybody seen this guy already, the Texas Law Hawk? If you haven't already, brace yourselves, because this is something else.
Ryan Wilson, Texas Law Hawk! Ryan Wilson, the Texas Law Hawk! Talons of justice! Due process! Two wheelies! It's hot out here! Brian Wilson! El Halcón de la Ley! Brian Wilson! The Texas Law Hawk!
Hey guys!
Bye!
Happy Halloween! Well.
It's no refusal weekend, so you have to blow! Otherwise, you're gonna lose your license! These things are 100% accurate! Blowing it! Surprise! Failed! Blow!
Yeah, I don't think so.
Someone just called me! That's why you don't blow! Brian Wilson! The Texas Law Hawk!
If you or a loved one been arrested, you should call Brian Wilson, the Texas Law Hawk, today.
Only in Texas, right? 1.8 million views on YouTube and counting. I don't know, but I've been told he does pretty well with that. We're going to come back to the craziness of why that works. And Lowell, the Hammer Stanley, you will like this one a lot because this is right up your alley. I just had to include this because this guy is awesome in my books.
When I take on the insurance company,
I ain't settling for no small dough. I'm hunting for the big bucks. I'm Mike Slocum, the Alabama Hammer. You've been hurt in a car wreck. Let me hunt down the big bucks for you. Call me right now.
Huh? So what we find that in, when you're stuck in stage one, the one thing that will move the needle for you faster than anything else is to make your message better, to make you stand out, to not be experienced, to not be trusted, to get results. So what we find is when people come to us in stage one, they always usually ask us a lot of distribution questions. Avo's calling me. Should I invest money with Avo? Legal Match. Should I do Legal Match? FindLaw is calling. Hey, I got SEO. I got pay-per-click. You know, you guys know all the people that call you. And obviously very timid because you guys, all of us in the room have been burned about 1,000 times by vendors. And it really has less to do with where you distribute it and a lot more with what you say when you distribute it. So it's more about how your Avo profile looks or what you say on your website and less to do with where you distribute it. And so Ken and I have a little simple formula, which is if you spend a dollar on advertising, you should get $6 back. If you don't, it is a sure sign that your message is broken and you need to go back to the drawing board to fix it. So a couple of ways I've seen this work is, and what I want to show you is really interesting, is most of these really have nothing to do with their competence as lawyers, and it has everything to do with personality-driven factors, which are what distinguishes you. So one of our members, highly, highly successful in North Carolina, and she has a Christian-only personal injury law firm. And it's awesome, too, because when you call her, you get this like kind of God music while you're on hold. It's just like, oh, right? Like you feel like you're on a sermon. Great lawyer, gets great settlements. It's not why people call her. Another one of our guys who dominates in South Carolina, hey, I'm a veteran. People just eat that up. Apparently, you know, everybody loves military people. We got a guy in Georgia that we just converted who was, I'm a former insurance adjuster, and I just saw the light and realized all the bad things I was doing. Ken, you were the big guy on the client service. He did the risk-free trial, which is hire us for 30 days. If you change your mind, I'll help you find another lawyer. Now, any of you can do that, but of course, he's the only one who actually said it in his message. Some of us prefer to do it angry, not naming names. We got one of our members who actually stands on top of a truck and says, insurance companies need to be hammered. Honest to God, that's his commercial. I've seen it done calm. We got a really awesome member in Utah, and his whole pitch is just, hey, I help people with their medical bills, lost wages, and get fair compensation for the insurance company. That's his whole pitch right there. We got a member in Pennsylvania. They decided one day, hey, trucking accidents are worth a lot more. Why don't we just specialize in trucking accidents? Their whole website is only pictures of trucks. It only talks about trucking accidents. Their SEO and pay-per-click's only for trucking accidents. A guy I did some consulting for in Canada, in Calgary, he's a motorcycle rider, wanted motorcycle cases, didn't think to mention that he was a motorcycle rider to that audience, right? So obviously we fixed that. I've seen it done. Jerry Ojinski does the helpful expert kind of angle. And one of my clients also, a Pilma member who's awesome, his name's Keith. He's in Louisiana, and I went on his website, and his whole angle, his message was, everybody else charges you a third, I only charge a quarter, so it's cheaper to hire me. And I told him how horrible that was, and so we ended up asking him, like, why do you want to do this whole cheaper thing? And he says to me, and he got all, like, teary-eyed, and he says, when I was 16 years old, I was in a car, and his mother died in the car accident. He was in the car with her. And he went through the whole personal injury process first as a client. And he hated everything about it. His lawyers, he said, were really greedy, awful service. By the time he got a settlement check, they kept the whole thing. And he just felt like the whole thing had kind of soured him on the industry. And so he set out to change it. And I was like, for the love of God, why does your message not say that, right? Like, that's what makes you unique. And so I don't know what it is for you, but I do know that it's a lot of it is going to be based on your personality and less about experience, trusted results, because everybody's saying that. And one of the simplest things you can do if you're stuck in this stage, go to Google, search personal injury lawyer, whatever your area practices, your city, open the top 10 websites, see what they all say in common, make a decision to do something different than they're all doing. So it's really a change in thinking, because what we find is people in this stage, they're really kind of tactical when they ask us the questions. Where should I invest my money? What's the magic bullet that's going to fix all my marketing problems? And it's much more about thinking strategic. Like when I mentioned the lawyer who was willing to take really crappy cases for 2 years, why did he do that? Because he knew he could turn it into referrals, right? So The whole next level happens when you get very, very strategic in your message, when you focus on what are the types of clients I want, where are they, what do I need to say to get them in the door. So when you do this, you'll sleep a lot better at night because you'll stop worrying about where the next case is going to come from. But when you do, it doesn't solve all your problems. Apparently you get a whole new set of challenges, which happens when you get to stage two. So you, the people who raise their hand say you got a few associates, you're in stage two, and that's when employees start bringing you problems. So one of our members told me something along the lines of, I'm the poorest rich guy I know because his cash flow situation is really, really bad, but he has all this money tied up in cases that he's eventually going to get paid for. And I asked him, where's the money go? And he's, well, you know, employees got to get paid before I get paid. So this is how a day in stage two feels, where the cat is his employee. And the problem is when you get to stage two, it becomes beyond your ability to personally manage. And so you start introducing the magic thing called employees. And this is Homer Simpson says, if you don't like your job, you don't strike. You go in every day and you do it really half-assed. That's the American way. And this is Peter from Office Space who says, in any given week, I only do about 15 minutes of real actual work. He's your employee. Isn't that great? So there's stage two. When you get to stage two, I would say the overwhelming thing we hear in stage two, easier to do it myself. The quality's better. I know how to do it better. I care. And so the problem with that is you only have so much time in a day, and your ability to grow your practice gets really, really stunted if you have to do everything. If everything has to go through you, it's a long, long day at the office. So, you know, the overwhelming thing I would say in stage two is often people just don't know a better way to do it. And so they're stuck with kind of half-assed Homer Simpson employees that make their lives difficult. And so when you do this right, Rob Levine is in New England. He's the member I mentioned who went from basically zero to hero in 4 years, and he's the 800-pound gorilla very, very quickly. And he, do you remember what he said at our mastermind meeting? He said, I was the biggest asshole in the world to work for, his words, not mine. And now they do something once a month just to show their employees how much they're appreciated. He brings a massage person in to give everybody massages once a month. He has pizza parties, events. And he goes out of his way to get the best, the brightest people, and he even like gives them the grand welcome. Like when in his office, when you get a new employee or when you get a new client, they get a big fancy gift basket to welcome them. He also does it for his clients, and I remember him saying, now he's so busy, he's signing these 100 at a time. Eddie Fair is the one I showed you before. Eddie had a $10,000 video produced to sell the idea of coming to work for Farrah and Farrah. And the reason he did that, because he knew how important it was to get A-plus superstar employees. So if you look at your employees right now, and you just, in your own head, if you look at them and you can't honestly say that they're 8 out of 10 or better, then you need to fix your hiring process, because otherwise you're making your life so much harder. So I just talked to Peter, one of our members in Chicago. I won't use his last name since he's a bad example of what to do. And he's your typical average frustrated lawyer in stage two. And what that means is, it's easier to do it myself, can't give work to employees. They don't have the same quality I am or I do. I've never really had good luck with hiring people. I tried once, never gonna do it again. So the biggest thing that's gonna get you if you're in this stage, getting unstuck, is to get better people, because the sooner you have quality people, it gets a whole lot easier to delegate. So the question we always ask ourselves is, why are they stuck? It's because I'm surrounded by assholes. That's how most lawyers feel in stage two when they first start bringing in staff. And the reality is people always say lawyers are bad at delegating. I think lawyers are bad at hiring, because when you have good people, it's actually very, very easy to delegate. In fact, one of the things Ken taught me, because we're actually going through this in my agency, is how to get really good people. And for the longest time, you know, I carried all the burden of everything on myself. And now I'm just like, no, you just do it. I don't care. Whatever you come up with is fine. So the one thing that will change your practice in stage two more than anything else is to know how to bring in superheroes. So I'm Canadian, so our superheroes are a little bit different. But the principle applies. Which, by the way, if you're wondering, I'm from near Detroit, so we're actually close enough to hear the gunshots. That's a picture of downtown Detroit. Bankruptcy, divorce, liquor. One-stop shopping, really, right? Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, actually one of the things that Ken has really been monumental in helping me, we're actually going through a stage two to stage three transformation in my practice, or in my agency, because one of the things he taught me is really, this applies to anything that is a high-level service kind of business. Like, this is really, you know, even though we do this for law firms, it really, everything applied to what we were doing. And I set a goal like a year ago, because often when I do these things, I'll get people come up to me after and say, hey, can you help me do what you're doing? And fortunately, I had a couple of people say that I want to innovate something, and that's kind of what I do, so I'm willing to be your guinea pig. And so I set my mind on Facebook ads, because I've been told forever, Facebook ads do not work for PI lawyers. Don't even try it. Don't bother. Even some of the best people in the industry are like, no, we struggle with it. It's really, really hard. And so, you know, I brought in a bunch of team members, and every day they told me it was impossible, which is always nice to hear when you're like, this is what we're going to do. And they're like, no, let's do something else. And they kept saying to me, why don't you just do Google AdWords? People are looking for PI lawyers. And my answer was the same. You guys, if you were here in the morning, you saw this same stat from Michael Mogul. I can never say that word. Best mesothelioma lawyer. $935 a click. The top 100 most expensive pay-per-click on Google, 78 of them are lawyers, and the vast majority of them injury lawyers. And so if you're doing industry average, which by the way, according to Google, is 4.25% of people calling you, roughly 1 in 25, it means for some of these areas of practice, you're going to pay $10,000 just to get a phone call. Not a signed case, but a phone call, right? That's insane if you're doing average. And so one of the beautiful things is we finally, I want to say like 45 days ago, we cracked the code, and now we've been consistently getting cases for $250 to $500 in PI on Facebook. And you know, holding up across different markets too, that's one of the beautiful things where like we didn't just get lucky once, like we're able to do this consistently. And I would love to take all the credit for it, but it was actually what Ken taught me in bringing in my team. Like my superstars solved that. In fact, it was kind of funny because I call him my Asian henchman, but my partner, Steven, he just said, why don't we just look at all the best lawyer advertising that there is, and every time we hear something we like, we'll just write it down. And he just wrote it down and wrote it down. And every time we decided at the end of it, we're like, oh my God, this is gold. And we combined it into this like really well-crafted story, and we tried it on Facebook, and we're like, holy shit, it worked, right? Like, because I'd been in so long, we had been told that it didn't work. And the point I tell you that story is that's what's possible with superstars, is people who solve your problems, not bring you back more. Actually, this was kind of funny. It says, I just clicked on the top result for best mesothelioma lawyer. I can never say that word. That was satisfying. I almost expect an engraved thank you note from Google, maybe a hat or something. And replied, I bet it's going to cost them $10,000 just because of this post from people clicking on it. That's insane. I bet you it's a lot higher than that. So the change in thinking in stage two is a lot of times, like if I look at Peter, the person stuck in stage two, when he needs to hire somebody, his mindset is, how can I just get a warm body in there quickly? And so his hiring process looks like probably a lot of ours already looks like, which is, I'll get a bunch of resumes, I'll interview a couple people, I'll choose from the best three, and my interview sounds a lot like, hey, tell us about your last position. Cool. And then hire somebody. And the problem with that is lots of people interview well, but don't actually perform well. Lots of people interview very poorly, but are really good. So, you know, one of the things that it's really awesome about some of the people I've learned is they treat hiring like an audition, because, you know, one of my mentors taught me is like, if you go to play bass in a band, they don't go, tell us about the last three bands you played in. They make you get out your bass guitar and play it, right? Like, and hear how you sound. And so, you know, it's really all about bringing in superstars and having a way to test that they actually are superstars. So when you start to bring in the superstars, this will pave the way to go to stage two, which is your income will grow, the business itself will get easier, the training will get easier, and you'll have a clear chain of command. And the beautiful thing about why this five stages of law practice growth is so powerful is every time you go up one rung on the ladder and you get your system in place, your income goes up and your hours go down. Now, you may want to spend a lot of hours at your law practice. Some people love practicing law, but most lawyers here would be quite happy living like Ken did, golfing and fishing, or Mr. Adler, who spends 3-4 months in Aspen. Well, he signs up 1,500 cases a month, right? So that kind of leads us into the next stage. When you start getting good at employees and you start getting good at bringing cases in the door, you reach that stage where we call it mid-sized practice mat, which is stage three, and that's when you're managing or you have an office manager, but you're involved in the day-to-day management and all the crazy employee stuff. So when you got there, you probably thought this is what stage three was going to feel like. you're just going to be living the Scrooge McDuck lifestyle because you're going to get so much money. Especially when you're in stage one, you think, if I could just get cases in the door, all my problems will be solved. But there's this funny thing where they actually expect you to do stuff. Like, you can't just take cases and collect checks, apparently. So how stage three actually feels is a lot more like this. And the biggest thing we see in stage three is you've built up your practice primarily through your own hustle, through your own ability to just work your ass off. And what happens is, the unfortunate downside is that everything depends on you. And so in order to get things done, everybody brings, you know, Dan Kennedy described it, having employees is like 100 monkeys coming to you all day long asking for bananas. And that's what it looks like in stage three. And of course, every time you go up the growth ladder, this always happens when you first get there, is the quality of your legal brand will slip. And you'll be really frustrated about the fact that, like, you know, cases aren't getting done the way you hoped they were getting done. So the sticking points we see is really that they don't necessarily know what's going on in their law practice in a really deep, fundamental way. And that means they have no real benchmarks, and they don't necessarily know their numbers. And so obviously, the real key is systems. You know, as Rusty kind of pointed out, when you get into having systems, it allows you to kind of clone your own quality standard for doing things without you having to constantly enforce it. So when you're in stage three, this is a little math joke for the kids keeping score at home. Shit got real. And actually, I really like this kid. He said, it said find X, and he just circled it and said, here it is. Stage three guys always think they know their numbers. The reason why Ken and many of the other people mentioned it, because when we do consulting with them, we always say, hey, what percentage of cases do you sign up that you want? And they always say 90, 95%, almost 100, I get every single one I want. And it's never actually true, and it's never even close to true, because they don't actually know their numbers. So the right way to do this, we have one of our awesome members, Ken Levan, who's just a genius. And Ken is actually, he's an SSD in Florida, and they do, they get the entire case, and I mean not just the advertising costs, but he processes including all his overhead, all his employees. He knows his numbers so well that it cost him $480 to service a case, including, like I said, advertising, turning the lights on, everything, start to finish. And the fact that he knows that is just a testament to what a genius he is. Funny story about David. David's a lawyer I did some consulting for in Vancouver. He's kind of the 800-pound gorilla there. And I asked him the question, like, because what we usually find in stage three, almost always, they're never as good at answering the phone as they think they are. They're spending a lot of money to generate phone calls, and they don't realize a lot of it is being lost. So I asked him the question, what percentage of your cases do you sign up? We got the typical 90, 95%. I'd say almost 100. And so something didn't feel right about that. So I hung up the phone with him, and I went, and I clicked record, and I called his office, and I said, oh, you know, I've been injured. I hurt my back. Insurance company is giving me the runaround, and I'm not really sure what I'm doing, but they're asking for a recorded statement. And they proceeded not to sell me. And then I just sent him the recording by email and said, do you still think you sign up 100% of the cases you want? Because they did nothing to kind of encourage me to get in the door. And it's crazy, but people judge your entire law firm by the person who gets paid $12 an hour to answer the phone and make it a giant decision about who you are. It's such an important leverage piece. But the example with David is the reason why he was losing money is because he did not know his numbers. And Ken has a saying, you can't manage what you can't measure. Or, yeah, that's right, okay. But you know, if you don't know your numbers, it's very hard to scale beyond stage three because everything will be kind of driven by like a gut feel. And the problem is gut feel works really, really well in stage one and two because you're involved in the day-to-day and you know everything that's going on. But when you start managing at a high level, if you do not start treating it like a business, that's where your growth will flatline. So it's really a change in thinking, which is being really more strategic about systems. This man right here is so anal that, like he said earlier, they said he had a process for going to the bathroom, and he would test people on it. And the reason he did that, though, is really, really smart, which is to be able to clone himself, to be able to manage his practice at a very high level and know what's going on without having to do everything himself. So what we find is when you get this right, like when Ken Levan, I asked him, how do you manage his practice? He says, I go in Monday morning, I look at 20 different charts.
What systems do you use?
I mean, Ken, you could answer that question better than I could.
Yeah. So, talking about law firm systems. So, you got systems and using benchmarks. If you get everything systemized, processed out, then you start setting benchmarks. Like, and you can benchmark anything, and a benchmark is nothing more than a measurement. Say, like, I want to know that once a client is signed up, that the letter, reserve letter goes out within 48 hours, and they got a checklist. And then I know that a certain package goes to the client. That's a checklist. That's got to be done in 72 hours. And you do that. One of the key, and there's key ones, what I call key performance indicators. I'm real anal about when somebody gets released, I want to make sure that that a demand goes out within 45 days. And then after the 45 days, I either want the case settled or I want a lawsuit filed within another 90 days. Now, there's exceptions, but I run reports, and if I see numbers that don't look right, I run reports on notes entries. I had a rule in my law firm, if you don't put it in notes, it didn't happen. And then what I would do is I would run reports, especially on newer people, and I kind of got the average by running people that are really good, how many notes they put in. They might put in 50 notes a day. And then you might have a paralegal that might not put in that many. If she's a litigation paralegal, she might not put as many in as a case manager. But you see what their job position is. And if I got a girl that's only putting in 10, and everybody else is averaging 40, two things are either one or two things happening. She's not doing her job, or she's not putting the shit in there. And so it's a red flag. So I want to go in there, and so I've created this system of checklists and processes, just like Barney was talking about. I don't know if you were here when Barney was talking about the law firm systems. But once I get the systems put in, then I can actually put benchmarks in, and then I can measure. I can run these reports. They're not going to tell me everything, but it's going to tell me when I got clogs in my system, and then it makes me go in and investigate and find out what is the problem. I mean, it's not the all for all, but it's sure a hell of a lot better way than just saying something don't feel right.
Yeah.
Do you use Lexis or Westlaw? What's the outlook?
We use Needles. A case management system, you can run reports. I had 50 reports I ran. And I would actually teach the staff how to run these reports so that they could self-manage themselves. You know what I'm saying? And I had the lawyers, they could run the reports so they could know how many demands did I get out this month? You know, how much, and we'd put the value of the cases and I'd see how close they were to it at the end of the case from the beginning. And we had like three stages where they had to put in, because values change, you know, they can go up or down based on certain things, you know. A guy comes in with a soft tissue and you realize that it's actually a herniated disc and they end up with surgery. That might be a case you put $10,000 on to begin with, and then when you find out it's worth $500,000. So things change.
Yeah. Do you think it's more viable to have attorneys or paralegals? Attorneys are cheap nowadays.
Yeah, far as what, handle cases?
Yes.
I think it just depends on the market you're in. You know, there's a lot to be said for both. If you hire an attorney, you got to think that probably they're not going to stay there forever, but nobody does anymore, so it might not make a big deal. I think my deal is just get the best people you can get. And one thing he didn't say is I'm real big on testing, and there's a couple of guys out there, John Bean and then Jay Henderson, and I don't, and they'll tell you, everybody at Pilma, I test everybody. I get it down to two or three people, I test them. Even when me and Barney were thinking about going in together, I said, Barney, I got to test you. He said, no problem. I said, it's not, you know, we're not. I don't really tell him what to do. He can try to tell me what to do. But I wanted to make sure that we would be a good fit, because I don't fit with everybody. You know, I've learned that the hard way. A big ass breakup in 2005 with a partner. I know that you don't matter how good they are or how good I am. Sometimes you just don't fit. And so I've got now where if I do anything with anybody, I make them, you know, if I was going to get married again, I'd probably make them take this test to make sure that we're going to jail.
With a process and procedure, by the way.
Yeah.
Is that helpful?
75%
of
partnerships end. Yeah. They do. It's like a marriage. Yeah. Right. So if you test it, you know, and then also the thing about Jay Henderson test, he can tell you how to manage that person, what motivates them. And that's very important to me, because some people it's money, some people it's peer recognition, some people want to feel like they're part of something bigger, but some people it's just strictly money. But most, they've done studies, Number one reason people quit is because they got a shitty boss. The second reason is because they feel they're not appreciated. The third reason is money. Yeah. So money is like number three on the list. It's not the money most of the times.
Yeah.
You see, they got an asshole for a supervisor, or they just don't feel appreciated. And that, I mean, I've got a bunch of presentations I've done on hiring and firing and motivating, and we ain't got time.
Yeah, I got a whole speech I'm doing.
Oh, you got a whole speech you're doing on that? I'm sorry.
Yeah. Was that helpful, by the way?
That was very helpful.
Okay, cool. Just because we're on a time crunch, I'm going to. So what happens is when you start getting really good at managing the numbers and you can manage it like a business, you'll reach stage four where you start to function as a really more as a partner and you own it more like a business where day to day you're thinking about how to grow the firm, how to bring good people, and you're working on very strategic objectives, but you're not involved in any of the day-to-day decisions. Usually we find by that time you're kind of in the 1,000 to 2,000 cases annually, that kind of range. This is how I think a day in stage four should feel, which is because it is quite the accomplishment. I mean, law school, 7 years, plus most people who get there take 20 years. I mean, it's a 30-year project to build for most people to get to stage four. So if you've done that, kudos to you. The bad news is when you start to get bigger on this scale, that's when the quality really starts to slip. And it looks like, and my girlfriend Trish in the back can attest to this, it looks like me trying to do any handyman work around the house, which is this. So the quality output of your legal firm, that's what happens when you start to reach stage four, and that's when you start getting kind of angry state bar complaints about how they're not calling me back. And you know that your firm's output is not where it needs to be. Things aren't getting done. There's just so many mistakes by staff, and you just can't keep up with all of it. And so what you get into in this stage are really issues of scale, like how do I, you know, expand what I'm already doing and do this at a much higher level, and all kinds of issues with productivity. And so there's really a right way to wrong way to do this. George Sink is one of our, really one of our probably crushing it more than anybody else members in South Carolina. And I want to say like 3 years ago, he set out to expand his practice dramatically. He was already the market leader, and he's since tripled it in that amount of time. But what's interesting about him is he has the intention of giving his practice on to his son. So he's actually taking 2 days a week off as he's working on the scale, which is very, very difficult to do, which forced him to have to think about it, you know, and less to actually be involved in the trenches. And the wrong way to do it, this man over here, when you got to stage four, he got so good at getting cases, you know, through TV and all his referral systems, but real shit at cash flow, right? Like you almost went, he got to stage four and almost went bankrupt for 6 months, didn't collect a paycheck, probably lost a few hairs, turned a little gray during that time period. Wasn't a whole lot of fun. So if you don't have the scaling and the infrastructure, like he told that guy earlier, who wanted consult, give me, you know, I got a $5 million case, bring me $60 million. The problem with that is if you don't have the infrastructure, you can literally bankrupt yourself because, you know, it's a difficult situation with the cash flow. So it's really all about systems of scalability. Like George Sink in one of our mastermind meetings, it's funny the challenges that happen with scale. But he told us that his biggest problem in the last 3 months is that he got so many phone calls, they blew up their phone system, and nobody at the phone company knew how to fix it. So he was like losing thousands and thousands of phone calls. How would you guys like to have that problem, by the way, right? There's so many phone calls, I can't handle them. Turns out the solution was, in his case, that it turns when you transfer a call on your phone line, that actually uses two phone lines until that person hangs up the phone. And so they eventually realized that if they have 250 employees, they need 500 phone lines to be able to manage it. But those are the crazy things when you start happening in scale. He's running out of good talent to hire in a state because pretty much everybody who's anybody already works for him. And so these are the things that start happening when you get to the scale. So the change in thinking is being really very, very strategic about scale and asking yourself a lot of questions like, how can I get this done at a higher level that does not involve me doing it? How can I step away from this and expand it? And ultimately, your clients will be the one who benefit. So the transformation happens really when you start doing stuff, when you start innovating in your space. You no longer are bound by the constraints about what every other lawyer is doing in every other market. Your productivity goes up, and you're starting to become the 800-pound gorilla, which leads to stage five, which we call preeminent Paul. And I'd say, how many people do you think we have? Maybe half dozen, stage five? Yeah, that's probably what. So that's when you really have a practice that runs without you that you could sell for a very large check, but you can walk away from at any time and it will still continue to function. Like like the gentleman I mentioned who spends 3 months in Aspen and signs up 1,500 cases a month while that's happening. So this is how I imagine, anyway, because I'm not anywhere close to that, but this is how I imagine a day in stage five feels like. You just sit around doing this all day long. And what happens is really, when you get into this level, nobody's on the same page. Like, it feels like, anybody ever have this in your practice where employees are competing with each other because they're trying to get promoted faster than the other one, and so they're trying to make each other look bad, and there's cliques, and everybody, you know, has a different agenda in the firm, what's going on. So you start to get all these kind of culture issues that didn't happen when you were a smaller firm, because you could just say, hey, straighten up, right? But you can't do that when you got 12 different locations. Like John Morgan tells me, how he spends a day is he just flies around on his private jet from location to location, and that's how he like manages his staff. But obviously he doesn't know every employee personally. It gets a lot harder to see what's going on in the details in the trenches. So what we find is a lot of times the guys in stage five, they're so good at what they do, but they're also like incredibly full of themselves, and they think their firm, you know, their shit don't stink. And so as a result, they start to make it about themselves and forget what got them there, which is everything about the client and what mattered to the clients. So there's also a whole lot of distractions, like, you know, people, you were saying when you were there, people just pitching you, hey, want to invest in my business? Like, he got pitched a strip club. Like, you know, there are all kinds of core detractions that pull away from what you're trying to do. So there's really not a wrong way to do stage five. If you got to stage five, you obviously know what you're doing. But, you know, a good example that I mentioned is Jim Adler, the Texas Hammer, who's, you know, signing up 1,500 cases a month, spending 3 months in Aspen, and has the ability to walk away from his practice while it still grows. You know, most of us don't have that, where if you leave and came back, would your practice be bigger than when you left? So the solution is really to get back to the basics and to fall in love with your clients and to really get everybody on the same page. And so Ken's real big on, you know, creating an in-house university and training and actually having a newsletter just for your own office, which becomes necessary when you start to have multiple locations and multiple practice areas. Everybody needs to know what's going on. Because you're always thinking about strategy and you're never thinking about actually doing. And you know, when you're in stage one, for example, most of your day is spent doing and very little of it is left over time to actually do thinking about where you're trying to go and what your goals are. So the transformation, what we see is when people really get stage five mastered, it's like kind of conquering the world is what their kind of objectives are. And so they get focused on getting everybody on the same page, and they start expanding into other practice areas, multiple locations. And usually, most people don't want to get to stage five, by the way. So if you're looking at that thing and I don't want to be that person, you don't have to. As long as you go up this ladder, you'll find that your income will increase, your hours will go down, and your freedom to enjoy whatever lifestyle you want will benefit. Usually the people in this stage five, their reason for doing it is much deeper. Like George Sink told me, didn't care about his cost per case, didn't care about his numbers. He has a vendetta against the insurance company. This is way deeper. Doesn't care how many employees it takes. This is his mission in life, is to get even. And so, you know, real hard to compete with a guy who doesn't care about his cost per case, by the way. I don't care. I'll spend $6,000 to get a $6,000 case, as long as the insurance company loses. So, quick question for you guys. How would you guys like to be able to kind of put this in your own practice? I assume everybody's going to say yes. Okay, good. I see some head nodding. This is what I want to tell you really just quickly about, if you're not already a PILMA member, what some of the benefits are. And I kind of thought about different ways I could tell you it's awesome, but it would just be easier to let the actual members tell you. So I'm going to play a video and you can hear for yourselves.
Things really began to change for us when I met Ken Hardison and the PILMA group.
They tell me to do something, I do it. And I have implemented 80% of at least of what Ken Hardison has suggested. It's worked wonders for me.
Ken is someone that I view as a genius in the world of legal marketing.
I don't know what I'd do without it.
If I didn't have PILMA, I'd have to invent it. I'd have to find it someplace.
Before I hooked up with Ken and PILMA, it was getting cases was always more haphazard. I would have to take referrals that were not advantageous. I would have to take cases that I didn't really want to do.
PILMA is how we found out the ways that you can grow your law practice and experience really phenomenal fast growth.
Since I've been a member of PILMA for years. I've got the systems in place that generate the leads and generate the cases, so I'm not constantly stressed out about wondering where the next case is going to come from.
PILMA is like the secret tool in the toolbox for me.
Since I joined PILMA over 2 years ago, our caseload has doubled.
But for Ken Hardison, I mean, $500,000, like finding it on the sidewalk.
Our caseload has increased tenfold in size since joining PILMA.
And we wouldn't be where we are right now without PILMA.
By the end of June this year, I had already opened more cases than I had opened all of last year total.
Before I joined PILMA, it felt like I had a pretty crappy, very stressful job.
We tripled our internet leads.
You better get to PILMA right away, because you're going to learn some things that you can't learn anywhere else. And if you don't learn them, it's going to cost you money. And you're not going to be as successful as you can be, or as they say, you're not going to be all that you can be unless you come to PILMA.
PILMA is helping us achieve our dream.
We have made a return on our investment many times over.
You could not pay me at this point to not be a participant in PILMA.
There's not enough money available in the world for me not to come back.
I will never leave.
There's no amount of money that you could pay me that would be worth it for me to give up my PILMA membership. Because it's priceless.
Yeah, there you heard it. You better get to PILMA right away. That's my favorite part of that video. So if you guys are interested in that, we've got a little spot in the back. Right now we're doing 3 months risk-free, right? Yeah, so it's $197 a month if you want to try it. And you know, if at the end of 3 months you don't feel like it was worth it, we wouldn't feel like we earned your money anyway. So happy to give you a refund. That's kind of Ken's policy. And we've also got a couple of awesome events coming up. So if you guys are interested in kind of more stuff like this, be sure to check that out. There'll be people in the back corner who can give you more info. That's really all the time I got for you guys. So may the force be with you. And Tom Hanks says, thanks.
Thank you. Great job.